Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Vicent Larivière. I'm the Canada Research Chair on the Transformation of Scholarly Communication. Unfortunately, I cannot be with you today because of visa issues. So for the next 10 minutes or so, I want to say a little bit about limitations of bibliometric indicators. We're going to go over two types of limits. The first are the technical limits, mainly related to the coverage of the databases, and then to the limit of specific indicators, mainly the impact factor. And then I just want to briefly discuss about adverse consequences that bibliometric indicators have for scientific production of countries, mainly developing countries or countries that don't have English as their main language. So the first technical limit is actually that no database covers all of the published literature. And this is particularly true in the social sciences and humanities. In the natural sciences, the research objects have an international aspect. If you study the electron will behave the same way in China than in the United States. But that's not true in the social sciences and humanities. There are some national problems. The history of Brazil is different from the history of Canada or the United States. And so for these disciplines, we need to have local journals. And these local journals are not indexed in the international bibliometric databases. And so when it comes to measuring social sciences and humanities research, these big databases index quite well research on history of the US or sociology of the American family, but they don't measure so well research that is being done on Brazilian or French families, for instance. That's the first limitation. The other limitation is the fact that there's no book included until recently, actually. Thompson created the Book Citation Index, but before that, we had no hold on all of the book literature that is being published in the social sciences and humanities. And that's a very big limitation. If we look at this curve here, this is the percentage of references that are made to journal articles in the various disciplines. So we see that in medical sciences, basically about 95% of the references are made to journal articles. So when we count articles, it makes sense. We're measuring mostly what researchers publish. In engineering, it's kind of lower. We're at about 67%, so there's still one-third of the scientific production that we're missing. Now, when it comes to the science, social sciences and humanities, well, in literature, humanities, and history, only about 20 to 30% of the cited literature consists of articles, and the rest is mainly books. And so when you're measuring articles in literature, well, you're only counting a maximum of about 20% of what researchers publish. Up there you see psychiatry and economics. Of course, these two disciplines are closer to the natural sciences. And so, of course, they cite a higher proportion of journal articles. But not only these databases don't measure journal articles, but until recently, we did not measure very well conference proceedings. This has changed over the recent years, but we see that conference proceedings account for a significant proportion of cited literature in computers. So about 20% of the research that is being cited in informatics and computing is conference proceedings. And so if you only count journal articles in those disciplines, then there's a big proportion of the literature that you're actually missing. So the coverage is a big limitation of bibliometric indicators. There's no database that covers everything in terms of types of document. Then when it comes to languages, we see that the main databases, and that is the Web of Science until recently, of course, Scopus covers slightly more than the Web of Science, and it would have to be, what I'm presenting here would have to be done with Scopus as well. This has not been done yet. But when we look at the Web of Science, we see that it has a very high English bias. And what we have here is the proportion of journals in Ulrich. Ulrich is a database of periodicals, of scientific periodicals. So the papers are not indexed, but the journal is indexed as a whole, and it has a language. And so Ulrich, in this case, gives us the entire population of journals. And we see that English accounts for 78% of journals taken altogether, But 89% of those in Thompson, so English is overrepresented in the natural sciences, but it's also even more overrepresented in for social sciences and humanities. So 75% of Ulrich journals and social sciences are in English, but 90% of those in the Web of Science are in English. So there's a big bias in favor of English. And what countries are underrepresented? What languages are underrepresented? Well, it's all other languages but English. So Portuguese is underrepresented by 86%, same for French, same for German, etc. So there's a bias when it comes to types of documents, but also a bias when it comes to languages. Another bias when it comes to citation indicator is the length of the citation windows. So if you want to measure the impact of research in arts and humanities, you need to wait for quite a while, because basically the half-life of cited document is about 14 years. So in order to get half of the citation that a paper will obtain in arts and humanities, you need to wait for 14 years. So there's no way we can measure short-term impact in those disciplines using two-year citation windows, such as what is being used in the impact factor. Well, how to correct some of these limits? Of course, the creation of a book database solves some of these issues, but if you look at Thompson's Book Citation Index, it still has the same US-American bias, where books published by MIT Press or Harvard University Press are indexed, but not the books that are being published by publishers that are of lower importance or publishers that do not publish books in English. Of course, we can triangulate data sources, so using both Thompson and Scopus and also the Web of Science to really get a hold of everything that is being published, and the creation of local databases such as SciELO in Brazil or Erudit that we have in Quebec that basically indexes Quebec journals. Then let's move to the impact factor and its limit. I'm going to try to be very brief on that. Although it's being used as a measure of journal impact in general, it cannot be compared across disciplines because citations patterns vary quite a lot. Citations are quite skewed, so it makes no sense to use an average. We should use a median because we've got quite a lot of papers that are uncited within one specific journal. There's an asymmetry between the numerator and the denominator, so we count citations to papers in the numerator, and those papers are not counted in the denominator. It has a very short citation window, especially for the social sciences and humanities. It includes journal self-citations, and also it is less and less correlated with citations that are actually received by papers. So basically, what we see here is that's the value of the R-square between citations received by paper and the impact factor of the journal where the papers were published. And since the 1990s, we see that the relationship is decreasing. Why? Because papers are more and more independent of the journal where they are published. Researchers no longer subscribe to journals. They find papers online independent of the journals where they're published. So good papers can be found everywhere. And we see that this affects also the top journals. So PNAS, Nature and Science, are publishing publishing a less and less high share of the top cited papers. So for example, PNAS used to publish 9% of the top cited, the top most cited papers, and right now it's only 4%. So top cited papers are published in an increasingly high, diverse number of venues. And to conclude, I want to speak a little bit about what are the adverse effects of these bibliometric indicators. In some departments throughout the world, we're evaluating professors based on the impact factor of the journals where research is being published. And as we all know, impact factors are generally higher in international journals than in local journals. And so if we start using that as a measure of quality or as a measure for promotion, researchers will start to change their research topics. So if I tell you in your department you need to publish in the American Sociological Review, you're going to work on US families, not in Brazilian or Canadian families. And we see that I did a small analysis of the use of the word Brazil in scientific abstracts of Brazilian papers. And so when it's published in Brazilian journals, you find Brazil in abstract in 31% of the papers. When it's in US journals, it's only 15%. So it means that when Brazilian researchers want to publish in US journals, they need to stop working on Brazil. They have to start working probably on the US or more general problem. And this creates an adverse effect where in our own universities, you don't have experts in your own local problem, but you have experts in international problem. And I think that's a big problem that is created by bibliometric indicators. So thank you and enjoy the conference.